David, thank you so much for the opportunity we have to be here. We thank you for your love. Father, this morning, we just want to try and give back a part of that love as we sing songs of worship and praise to you. And as we look into your word, Father, just guide us through this service. Be with us through it all. We pray in your son's name. Amen.
Well, I think we have two or more here today, so the Lord is with us here, and let's pick up some praise. Go ahead and stand, please. Children's Church.
Yeah. Morning.
Morning.
And it's amazing how you've gone just a couple of weeks and it seems like you haven't been here forever. Les came back from World War II without one arm and missing several fingers on the other hand. He has carried the price tag of freedom in his own body ever since. He is like so many who are among us who purchased and preserved our freedom at a great cost. It is a cost they can never forget because they bear on their bodies and their psyches the horrors of war. But Les came back. Tens of thousands of others never came back from World War II or Korea or Vietnam or from the deserts of. The old Crosby, Stills, Nash & Young song speaks truth, even in protest of war. Find the cost of freedom, buried in the ground, Mother Earth will swallow you, lay your body down. As U.S. citizens celebrate this Independence Day, let's remember that cost that has been paid to purchase freedom, not just for a nation, but for all people. There was a war for all the human race in which freedom for all people was purchased. This freedom was purchased at great cost as well. The symbol of that cost is not a hillside of white crosses or the tomb of the unknown or a black wall of names. As precious as these symbols are for those who know them and the people they represent, they do not compare to the symbol of the empty tomb. This symbol transcends ethnic and national boundaries. The empty tomb is the symbol of the cost of true freedom for all people. The cost of Jesus leaving the security and power of heaven and becoming earthbound and mortal, Philippians 2, 5 through 11. It is the symbol of the degradation of crucifixion before a jeering and mocking mob. It is a symbol of an agonizing death on a cross when he had the power to prevent it. It is also the symbol of 3 days in the ground, Jesus literally laying his body down. But the words to this tune are different. Find the cost of freedom no longer in the ground. You see, the empty tomb is a sign of ultimate freedom. It is a reminder that we no longer have to fear death. All of our mortal fears are conquered. As the Apostle Paul says, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? 1 Corinthians 15, 54-55. For the Christian, Independence Day doesn't come once a year. No, for Jesus' followers, Independence Day comes every Sunday. The early Christians met on the first day of the week, the Lord's Day, Revelation 1:10. Sunday to take up the Lord's Supper, Acts 27. This is their Independence Day. By the end of the first century, Sunday had become the Lord's Day. On this day, they remembered the Lord's death and anticipated his return because freedom from death had been won. Independence Day is the day of the empty tomb. Since the children had flesh and blood, he, Jesus, too shared in their humanity so that by his death, he might destroy him who holds the power of death, that is the devil, and freed those who all their lives were held in slavery by their fear of death, Hebrews 2, 14-15. So as each Sunday approaches, let's remember the cost of our freedom and give thanks.
Let us pray. Father, we come into your presence today, as we do every day, knowing that you are the great King of Kings and Lord of Lords, governor of all nations. The whole world belongs to you and everything in it. As we celebrate the independence of this great country, which we love and sacrifice for, we pray that you would speak to our hearts for the great freedom and liberty that you have bought with the blood of Christ for us. We may also celebrate every day, being free from our sins, knowing that you are walking and talking with us, that we have the power of God to go with us wherever we go. Let us to charge the gates of hell this evening on your behalf, knowing that you have already overcome,
Spirit. Let us do this all in remembrance of you. In Jesus' name. Amen.
inspired after prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much that we're able to be blessed with the freedom to come to worship you, sing praises, the freedom to be able to work, toil, labor this week. We just thank you, Lord, that we're able to do this because of so much sacrifice. The freedoms we have in giving your Son sacrifices his life for us. Just give a portion of our labor back to you, Lord. We ask you to bless this offering and bless the one who offers it. May this be the precious Son's name, Jesus Christ.
Cost to it because we wanted freedom. We wanted to be redeemed from what we had to what we wanted. And we want to talk about the three words you saw on the sign outside. The three words were
Redeemer,
Redemption, and Redeem. They're all different. Who here is the Redeemer? Jesus. How is Jesus the Redeemer? Died for our sins. And not just anybody. Could Kevin have died for our sins? Margaret said it had to be what? Sinless. But Jesus was born of the Virgin Mary, a sinner. So wouldn't he naturally then be a sinner? And if you're here for Wednesday night Bible study, over here we're going to discuss some. If you read on the Facebook page, you're going to find out that only the blood of the Father goes into the babe. And so with Jesus, only the blood of the Holy Spirit was part of the baby, not Mary's blood. And so he was perfect, whole. He was able to be the Redeemer. Now what made him the Redeemer? The perfect blood? What made him the Redeemer? Perfect sacrifice. So the answer to that is death. Death made him the Redeemer. Can you imagine? How many of you were born to die? No, death is a part of it, but how many of you were born for that purpose? Jesus was born so that he could die. We were born so that we could live. And live what? A life in him, right? The Redeemer. The Redeemer gives us that ability to live that life. Then it comes the word redemption. Redemption. What is redemption?
To be brought back.
To be brought back. Now, there are several ways of doing it. I mean, in the Bible times, if Vito borrowed $10 from me, Vito was then called indentured to me. That means Vito was mine until he what? Paid back the $10. Now, it's funny because in Bible times, if Vito borrowed $10 from me, I could have him jailed. Now, if I have Vito jailed, how likely is it that he's going to pay that $10 back? Not going to happen. They didn't have work programs in jail and everything like we have now. You know? But there he is, and he's there. And he could be redeemed. He could get redemption if what?
Someone buys him.
Somebody buys him. Somebody could buy Vito from me. I own him. He's sitting in jail. I'll let him rot there. But if somebody wants to redeem him, they can come to me and offer me his debt. How likely am I to take his debt from somebody?
Not likely.
Not likely. Why? He's worth more than his debt. I'm going to want his debt plus something. You know, for him to be redeemed, I want that. Now, for him to have that redemption, someone comes and buys him and they let him free. Is Vito free? No, he belongs to whom now? He belongs to Jeff, because Jeff came and paid his price, and now Jeff has Vito. And Jeff says, good, because now I don't have to feed the horses no more. Vito can feed the horses. And he throws them to work. Or, Vito could be the redeemer, in this case, and pay the price for Vito. Vito might work for him for a little while, and then he says, Vito, you're free. You've paid me back for the work. Yeah. Not likely. I know Jeff. That's why I chose him. But he could say he's free, and then Jeff becomes the redeemer, and Vito gets redemption because his price was paid by another. So we have redeemer, Jesus. We know that he's the redeemer. He's the only one that could pay for what? Sin. He's the only one that has the proper price for sin. What's the price? What was the price of your sin, Gary?
Death.
Beyond death, what did he shed?
His blood.
His blood is what covers our sins, right? So Jesus had to shed his blood and then die to pay the price for our sins. The only one that could do it. The only one that could cover us that way. Okay? Now I could buy anybody's debt. But I can't buy your sin. I cannot pay for your sins. And funny thing about sin is that Gary can commit it, but who might it affect?
Everybody.
Anybody and everybody. It's his sin, so it's going to affect him. He's going to pay a price for the sin, but it might also affect the rest of us. Now, how would it affect the rest of us? Well, Gary is a Sunday school teacher here. If Gary sins, it affects that class. If it affects the class, that class is sitting amongst us today, it's going to affect us. That old saying, one bad apple spoils the whole bunch.
A little bit of yeast.
I mean, it happens. And so here I am, standing before you as your minister, and this is hard. This is real. Because if I, as your minister, stumble, if I sin, if I fall, does it affect you? And what happens? I've sinned. Who's going to redeem me?
Jesus,
ultimately. And as your minister, I sin. Who's going to redeem me?
We do.
You could. How could you?
By praying for
you. By giving me redemption through
substitution.
Forgiveness. What's forgiveness?
Forgetting. Treating someone like it never happened.
Treating someone like it never happened. So, I have an affair. How many of you would treat me like it never happened? How many of you would remember? How many of you are sitting here not listening to a word I said? I mean, three of you got it. Three of you would redeem me. The rest of you said, "What in hell?" You're still thinking about it.
Many
are
not going to commit because
they were afraid of God. The honest truth is, you wouldn't have to do anything because I would be dead. But you know, I mean, redemption comes in different ways. We do different things. For America, redemption came in a battle, in a war against the Redcoats to win our freedom. Really? How many of you are free today? I'm asking the question, how many of you are free today? How are you free? I've been redeemed. How many people in this room have been redeemed? How many of you have a price paid for you? I mean, there are soldiers who paid a price that I could have the freedom to stand here today and preach the sermon that I'm preaching. I've been redeemed in that way. But moreover, I stand before you to be able to preach this sermon before you because I am redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redemption came my way because of an act of one. So we have the Redeemer, Jesus. We have redemption, and then we have the redeemed. I am the redeemed. What makes me redeemed? The Redeemer. through his blood that gave me redemption to make me redeemed. But am I always redeemed? What happens when I sin? Huh?
You're forgiven.
I'm forgiven.
Separated from God.
Immediately?
Separated from God.
When I sin, I'm what, Craig?
Separated from God.
Separated from God. When I sin, I become a slave again because of sin. And only when I get forgiveness, how, Becky? Ask. It doesn't just automatically, God doesn't automatically, oh, you said you're forgiven. I have to ask. There's the steps of salvation we talk about. Hearing, believing, confessing, repenting, being baptized. And that confessing, not only is it confessing Christ before man, but it's confessing our sins. And when I sat with little Wyatt a couple weeks ago, preparing him for baptism, I asked him, you know, what do we need to confess? Do you know what his statement was? Do I have to tell you in front of mom and dad? He knew what he had to confess, but he didn't want them to know. You know, how many of us are like that? How many of us don't want them to know? How many of us are embarrassed because we did it? Ashamed of what we've done? And yet the only way for redemption to be redeemed is through forgiveness, through us asking. The other part of that is repentance. What does repentance mean?
To change.
What did you say?
Being sorry.
Being sorry. The definition is to be so sorry of something that you promise to never do it again.
Turn from with tears.
To turn away from. To go the opposite direction. There's a lot of different definitions that are there if you look it up. But it's to be so sorry for that you promise not to do it again. Now, I sinned. I ask God to forgive me. I repented of it. Ask God to forgive me. Anybody here ever do the same sin again then? So, were you so sorry for it that you promised never to do it again? What happened?
I was redeemed.
You were redeemed, but what happened then that you did the same sin again? Did you forget? It's what?
Human nature.
Every time sin comes knocking, what do you have to do?
Confess.
Say it real loud.
Yeah. Choose not to answer.
Choose. Okay, understand this. It's a choice. I'm redeemed or I'm not by choice. I'm a sinner or a saint by choice. When sin comes knocking, I don't have to go back and do it. I've already asked God to forgive me of that sin, and here it comes again, and all I have to do is what? No. I have choices. I can make a choice not to put myself in a position to go into that sin again. If I'm an alcoholic, and I continue to go every night to eat dinner at the bar, what do you think is going to happen? If drugs is my thing, and I keep hanging around with the drug dealers, what do you think is going to happen? If food is my thing, and I put myself in a position to constantly be around food, what's going to happen? I mean, we can choose not to sin. I thank God every day that Jesus is my Redeemer, and not one of you. Because he has patience with me, or I think some of you would run dry.
Amen.
She's on vacation. She's not really here. But when you look at the whole thing between Redeemer, redemption, and redeemed, it's a choice. I chose Redeemer. I walked an aisle. I said the words of faith. I did something to say that I believe that Jesus Christ is the living God. I confessed Christ before man. Because I did that, because I went through with the act of faith of being buried in baptism, he became my Redeemer. I remember growing up, Dan Craig was our youth minister. He did this one thing in, we call it teen church. He did this one thing where he had a cross up front, and he had a box of nails, and he had a hammer. And he said, I accepted Jesus as my Lord and Savior. He went up to the cross, and he pulled the only nail on the cross out. And he says, look. And then what? I lied to my mom. No, I didn't take a dollar out of your purse. Nailed him to the cross. Dad took me to mow the yard. Didn't do it. Disobeyed him. Nailed him to the cross. And I go through scenario to scenario to scenario to scenario. And when he got done with his little lesson, that cross had nails all over it. And he said, what has to take place to get rid of the crosses? In order to get rid of the one nail that I had there, my sin, I had to accept Jesus as my Lord, my Savior, my Redeemer. He's mine, now what? Look at the cross. I mean, if we stood here today and I said, okay, John, let's start with you. What did you not do this week that God wanted you to do? Share with one point and we put a cross there. I mean, put a nail on the cross. Because sins of omission are just as much a sin as the sins of commission. And Kevin, what did you do this week? Where did you fail? And you share it. Craig, what did you do this week? Where did you fail? And I go around the room. Scott, where did you fail? And I go to every one of you and I guarantee you that this week, all of us, me standing right here, sinned and nailed him to the cross of you. He's the only one that we nailed to the cross. He's the only Redeemer. And the point Dan Craig made up there was, as many times as he needs to die for your sins, he'll die. Because he loves you that much. Because he's your Redeemer. But how many times do you want to nail him to the cross? I mean, if you had to physically pick up a hammer and nail every time you sin, put it in a cross, would you think about it more often? Would you maybe make the choice right? Just put that in your head. Every time I sin, I nail him to the cross. That day, as he hung there for me. 2,000 years ago, it was because of my sin. Because when Jesus died, he died for all the past, all the present, and all the future sins of this world. He died for the people that were gone, the people that were living then, and for us who are living today. For generations that are going to live tomorrow. He's the Redeemer. The only one capable of being it. The only one to come to this earth and live a sinless life. People try to discount the Christ, say, yeah, but he was God. The other scripture tells us he was fully human. You saw Satan take him to the wilderness, didn't you? Didn't you read about it in your Bible? When he took Jesus to the wilderness? And he did what? Tempted him. With everything that would tempt man. With power. With money. With glory. And he what? He denied him. He put it down. How did he put it down?
Quoting Scripture.
By quoting Scripture. Things that we read today. I mean, someone asked me 2 weeks ago in VBS, do we really have to memorize the Scripture? And I said to the kids, yes. It's extremely important. Why is it extremely important?
Not always going to have the Bible with you.
Huh?
Not always going to have the Bible.
Not always going to have the Bible?
It might be the only Bible.
I mean, at the rate our country's going, I mean, 10 years from now, the Bible might be outlawed. 20 years from now, the Bible might just be you might just remember it. It's something in the past that doesn't exist. And if your Bible's taken away from you, what would you recall? I think there's something there that says that cleanliness is next to godliness. No, that's not Scripture. Do unto others, then split. We used to say that all the time when I was a kid. No, that's not Scripture. And if you don't have it here, you may never have it again. Look at the POWs. While they were waiting to be redeemed from their capturers. What did they live on?
Scripture.
You know, John McCain will tell you, it's the Scripture that we recalled and recalled. And we would share with each other because I remembered some that he didn't remember and he remembered some I didn't remember. And we shared them and wrote them down and we had them. Because it's the only thing that made sense to get you through. The Redeemer who brings redemption so we can be redeemed. I've been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. And now filled with the Holy Ghost, I am. We sing that song, don't we? And it's that Holy Ghost that tries to guide and direct us from making the choices of sin that get us separated from God, that makes us to be redeemed again. And yet sometimes we still choose. Redeem means to set free by a payment of a price. Instead of our death, we have His. Instead of our blood, we have His. Every Sunday we come together around this table to remember that death, that broken body, and that blood that was shed to cover our sins. Man, I've been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. That sets me apart from two-thirds of this world. 80% claim to be Christian, one-third live. That means in this room today, with our count is 68, one-third, 22 of you are living it. 44 of you are fakes. If you go by the statistics, that's what it is in the world. So what are you today? Are you a living, redeemed child of God? Or are you a fake? Are you going through the actions? Are you just pretending? You see, because as I read the Scriptures, as I look into them, Ephesians 1:7 says, in Him we have redemption through His blood, the forgiveness of sins in accordance with the riches of God's grace. Titus 2:14, who gave Himself for us to redeem us from all wickedness. And every verse says all sin. Galatians 3:13, Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law. The curse of the law. What's the law? For all have sinned to fall short of the glory of God.
Lord God.
We're all. What's the wages of that sin?
Death.
Death. And get this. because I am a sinner, I deserve hell. That's what it's telling us. But the gift of God, is eternal life through Christ Jesus, his Son. How many of you are redeemed? How many of you live like it? It's easy to say I'm redeemed, but if I'm really redeemed, if Christ is my all in all, he's my redeemer, if I have redemption, if I'm redeemed because of that, how then should I live? Redeemed. Bold. Outright. I mean, just read Acts. Read the book of Acts. Once the apostles got it, understand it, they didn't get it all at first, did they? Jesus is on the cross, where are they?
Hiding.
Why are they hiding? Afraid. Afraid of what? They might be next. So afraid that Peter, hey, you're one of his. I don't know that man. Peter. One of his best friends. Oh yeah, surely you were with that man. We saw you. No, you're mistaken. I don't know him. You remember, he did it 3 times. Jesus, the Redeemer, did what for Peter?
Suffered and died.
Redeemed him. You remember when he came back? Peter, do you love me? Lord, you know I love you. Peter, do you love me? 3 times. Peter, do you love me? He restored him because of his sin. So that Peter on that day of Pentecost was what? Bold. Out there, wasn't he? He didn't care what happened to him. I mean, stories have it that he was crucified like Christ, but didn't want to be like Christ, so they crucified him upside down. And that's the stories. Bold. Out there for Christ. Because he was redeemed. Man, we're redeemed. How then should we live?
Christ.
I mean,
as Christ.
How many of you are redeemed? I am redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, filled with the Holy Ghost I am, and there's nothing I can't do in this world because of Him. I can do all things. How? Christ who strengthens me. There's a scripture in your head. For God so loved the world that he would redeem him with his only begotten Son. That's John 3:16. That's what it means. That's the redemption story right there. And we go on and on and on, and we have scriptures in our head. Cindy has the favor of everybody. What was it? Jesus wept. What did Jesus weep over?
Sins of people.
His friend dying? I think if he was alive today, he would weep over us. Because we're dying in our sins. I think he'd weep over us because we're redeemed and we're his. And death is coming. I cried when my dad died. I cried when my father-in-law died. I cried when my brother died. We cry at loss. And Jesus had a loss. But he knew the rest of the story. Lazarus, come forward. What did he do with Lazarus? Raised him from the dead, redeemed him from death. That's what the Redeemer wants to do for us. For the wages of sin is death, and he wants to redeem us from that death to a life everlasting. He wants to give us exactly what he's got. Life eternal with God the Father. If we'd be redeemed. So look at your life today. Do you know the Redeemer? Not know him, do you know him? Do you have a personal relationship with him? Are you like two in one, peas in a pod? Because you know him so well and he knows you. Do you have redemption because of the Redeemer? Have you accepted him as your Lord and your Savior? Today, are you redeemed by his blood because of his act of what he did for us? Are you redeemed because you've repented and asked for forgiveness of sins? Are you his because you've confessed him before man and confessed your sins to keep yourself clean and redeemed so that you have a promise and a hope of eternity with him? Maybe you're sitting here today and you've never given your life to Christ, that you need to know about this Redeemer, redemption, and being redeemed. Or maybe you're like me and you're his. You've been redeemed. Maybe today you need to be redeemed again. Maybe you need to set yourself back on the right path. Maybe you need to get it straight with him that this is me. This is what I'm going to do. I'm not ashamed to stand before you and tell you that I love Jesus.
Amen.
I'm redeemed by his blood, and I'm willing and able to confess my sins so that I can be right with him, so that I can stand here in front of you and share these words with you, so that you too can be right with him. And this morning, that's what this is all about. Are you right with him? It doesn't matter if you're right with me. It doesn't matter what you show here. I mean, you can fake all of us out, okay. You're not going to fake him. Are you living the redeemed life, or are you fake? Are you his, making a difference in this world for his kingdom? Or are you just doing your own thing? He knows. So this morning we're going to stand and sing, and if you have a decision to make, if you need redemption back to him, if you need to give your life back, he's standing here willing and waiting for you. First time ever, or for the 100th time, that we've got to go back and hold the nail from the cross. Whatever your choice, as we stand and as we sing, thank you. Themselves to a master. And the symbol of that in the Bible is they'll take the person who's going to be indentured and they'll put their ear up against a doorpost and they pierce it. And that master will put whatever he wants there to bark and show that it belongs to me. We could be an indentured servitude. We could choose to be Jesus, to allow him to be our master. To say, I'll do whatever the master tells me to do. No, I'm not going to take you to a doorframe and pierce your ear. We have a Savior who wants to pierce your heart, who wants to mark you as his, who wants to be in your life and of your life. And all we have to do is accept it and do it. So this week, go and be an indentured servant to him. Do his will where he takes you. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for today. We thank you so much for the ability we have to be here. Father, for our ability to sing songs, to worship you, to love on you, Father, to gather at your throne and to sit at your feet as we commune with you today. Father, as we took in the body and the blood, as we strengthen ourselves through you being in us. Father, through your word, to know that you're our Redeemer, our kinsman, Father, we just pray that as we go this week, we can be your indentured servants to serve you, to do those things you placed before us. And Father, we ask and pray that you'll give us something to do for you this week, someone to speak to, something to make a difference in this life for your kingdom. We pray all this in your Son's name. Amen. Don't forget,